Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Our meeting will now come to order. And I'm going to ask Ms. Bonney if she would do an invocation, please.
Yes, I will. As this is my last official duty for invocation, I ask each person present to bow their head and offer in silence a prayer to whichever God they worship. I ask you to pray for the persons going out of office, but especially for the persons coming into office. Pray the board will seek guidance for ways to keep or help eliminate the burdens and hardships placed on our county during these economical times, and give to them the guidance needed to make these decisions. We trust in God, to whom we pray for his will to be done. Please bow your head now for a moment of silence. Amen.
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 Okay, we are going to the old business, county manager.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. In front of you is a minute from the November 15, 2010 meeting, and if there's a motion for approval.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Motion's passed unanimously.
That's done. And now there's a recognition of Commissioner Long. Where is my... Can you stand up, Ms. Long?
I was comfortable.
It's all right. You make it up. The Alamance County Board of Commissioners express sincere appreciation to Angie Vaughn for her unselfish devotion of time, energy, and ability to the people of Alamance County by serving as County Commissioner from December the 4th, 2006 to December the 6th, 2010. Presented this 6th day of December, 2010 in Graham, North Carolina. And I thank you for that.
Thank you.
Any comments?
Yes, I do have some
comments. Okay, everybody.
If I can see it.
You can.
Okay. Thank you. Ran into Craig not too long ago and I said, please, this don't do anything. He says it was in the works. I said, what's in the works? And he took off out the door. So I had never found out what was in the works.
That's how he was.
Started going through the minutes and decided to title this The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. Well, it was taking up a lot of time going back for 4 years, so I think ugly is out. I think pretty...
Got lucky.
You're right. You're going to miss me. I took the seat in December of 06. And that was a Mr. Kenneth Hall expressed concerns about the trash along the roadsides in the county. And I followed that up with letters to the editor, calls to the landfill concerning tarps on trucks because they were not being covered. Sheriff's Department worked very nicely with us in trying to put people down there and tag trucks, pick up trucks that were going down that were not covered. It was very discouraging to see piles of trash on the road and trying to avoid them and not cause an accident. Mr. Albright wrote a resolution including the legal issues of littering. And all this came about, well, it concluded with a phone call I received this past weekend and to let me know how clean the route was to the landfill and how extremely nice, helpful, and professional the people working there were. The caller went on to say that things at our landfill went like clockwork. And Guilford County Landfill had a lot to learn from us. So I thought that was quite a compliment and And I say congratulations to Craig Thomas for that. January 7th, or January of 07, I requested an investigation to have our county meetings televised. Thanks to the hard work of MIS Director Frank Merrick, Scott Ward, Ron, and Ken, and that became a reality April 7th of 08. If I was still teaching, I would assign my kids to watch some of these meetings. It benefits the kids in school that can't drive. It benefits those working families that are not here. And it benefits the elderly folks that don't like to drive at nighttime. So I think it's fantastic, and there are other benefits to this being televised. April 1st of that year, we had the grand opening of the jail. Is that correct? That's what I saw in the minutes, and I thought, I didn't realize it was April 1st of all times. After that, we were able to get a permanent cap put on Medicaid, and that was coming off the backs of the property owners here in Alamance County, so that was a good thing. The prescription discount card program was scheduled. We had the ribbon cutting at EMS. Brian Haygood continually applied for grants for the Haw River Trail. He received the 2007 Outstanding Program Award. That was good. In 08, Susan Osborne presented information on grants. The first one would establish the first community family justice center in North Carolina. Tim Green was the interim health director at the time, obtained funds from the state to use for the dental equipment and supplies, which helped our children and pregnant ladies. Skip a minute, Pat Bailey, who is not an employee of the county, she's a frequent visitor, especially on the Uncle Eli's quilting party, and that is to be held on the first Thursday in April, and it's a designated annual event, so I just wanted to bring that up. Then going back to our employees, through the Duke Clinical Research Institute, our EMS has trained their people and greatly improved the speed of treatment, saving lives. So I say congratulations to Chuck Manzillis. David Leonard, hiding, was very instrumental in the purchase of Soul Source, I hope I have this correct, a mobile command unit, and we really saw that at work on that scene in the Bebbin train wreck that happened not too long ago. This is not inclusive, and it's not meant to be. It's just the highlights of what's gone on here in Alamance County in the last several years. These people, our people that work for the county, have their heart in what they do. They're good people. I said this is just an example of what's gone on here in Alamance County. And I want to take this a step further. We started the Child Endangerment Work Group a little over a year ago. It has grown and it's been extremely successful. Those very caring and professional folks are the ones that have made this a success. And I want to call out some of those names. Sam Parker, not here. Pam Thompson, here, from Family Abuse Services. Suzanne and Deanna Joey from Crossroads. Susan Osborne, Terry Johnson, Chuck Manzillis, Brian King, Craig Honeycutt, Deanna Manning, Danielle Woodall, Tyra Ross, Patrick Nadowski, Jeremy Teeter, Brian Haygood, Chief Mike Wozniak, Lynn Horn, Deborah Schutt, Al Smith, they're both from ABSS, Dr. Lane Anderson, Lieutenant Gilchrist, and Nelson Young of the Kiwanis Club. We are all there, and they're committed to our youth. And this program is continuing. I want to thank our county employees for that service to the county. You folks are great. I want to thank our management team. I want to thank my fellow commissioners. Mm-hmm. You're still gonna miss me. I want to thank my family and friends. And I especially want to thank the citizens of Alamance County for your trust and faith in me and giving me the opportunity for a fantastic voyage. It's a once in a lifetime, and I say thank you. God bless you.
The next is the new business with the administration of the oath of office. And first, we'll start with Alamance County Commissioners. Mr. Sutton has already been sworn in. And so we need Mr. Manning, if you will come up. I beg your pardon. He's official.
I have not drank the water yet. You may need it.
Let me just.
That's right.
You heard that.
That was a shocker.
Let me just say what a privilege it is to be here. My name is Tom Lambeth. I'm one of our district court judges, and it's my pleasure to swear two of the commissioners in. Mr. Sutton, I understand, has already been sworn in. Congratulations, Tim.
Thank you.
I have an appreciation for what an incredibly important job this is, being on the Board of Commissioners through the work I did on the school board, where we often worked with the commissioners. And I was honored a little while ago to swear the new school board in, and I told them the same thing I told Bill and Tom a little while ago, that I was going to challenge the two boards to work together, as they so often have. I want to thank them for asking me to do this. So with that said, let me ask you two gentlemen to please put your left hand on the Bible and raise your right. And I'm going to have you each state your name.
William A. Fleshley.
Tom Manning.
Each of you do solemnly swear that you will support and maintain the Constitution and laws of the United States and the Constitution and laws of North Carolina, not inconsistent therewith, and that you will faithfully discharge the duties of your office as County Commissioner for the County of Alamance. If so, say, so help me God.
So help me God.
And state your name again.
Tom Manning.
Do also swear that you will well and truly execute the duties of the office of County Commissioner for the County of Alamance according to the best of your skill and ability, according to law. So help you God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, gentlemen.
Thank you, Ms. Massey. At this time is the election of our chair and vice chair of the board, and we will begin with the chairmanship. Is there a nomination for chair?
I nominate Linda Massey as chair.
Second.
The nomination has been nominated Ms. Massey for chair and seconded by Mr. Boswell. Any other nominations at this time? No further nominations. All those approved, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you so much for this privilege. Thank you for the privilege of serving as your chair. And everybody doesn't know, I gave him some appointments today, too, by the way. But mine's the biggest, you see right here. So, I love this job, and I love Alamance County, and it's just a privilege to serve this county in the many places that I go to. And I just want to say that I will do my best to serve in a proper way and be. And also, I am for Alamance County, and I don't care what party you are. I'm for Alamance County. And I think that's. And I think that's the way I have to do it. And that's what I've tried to do for the past 2 years, and I will continue to make my best efforts to keep doing that. So thank you so much. Okay, now you want to do the next?
Now there are nominations for vice chair.
Yes, I'd like to nominate, in the spirit of bipartisanship, nominate Bill Ashley.
I'll second that motion.
Motion has been nominated and seconded. Any other nominations? There being no more nominations, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Bill Ashley is your vice chair.
It is a pleasure for me to be vice chair. I look forward to working with all the commissioners and all the people in Alamance County. I will do my best to do the best for the Alamance County.
Okay, back to me again. This is the approval of bonds of public officials, but I think it's Craig too. Craig, do you want to take that?
Our standard bond approval as far as at our reorganization meeting.
Okay.
The limits have not changed.
Okay. Do I hear a motion we accept the review of the bonds?
So moved.
Have a motion?
Second.
And second. All in favor? All right. All in favor say aye. Did I do that?
Yes,
sir. I was talking. Okay. That's approved. The administration of the Office for Soil and Water Conservation District Supervisors is next. I think Mr. Lambert is going to administer.
You need to grab two Bibles.
Right. All right. If each of you would please put your left hand on the Bible and raise your right. Would you please state your name?
James Fred Pullman.
David Andrew Lindley.
Do you gentlemen each solemnly swear that you will support and maintain the Constitution and laws of the United States and the Constitution and laws of North Carolina, not inconsistent therewith, and that you will faithfully discharge the duties of your office as Alamance Soil and Water Conservation District Supervisor, so help me God.
So help me God.
State your name.
James Fred Pullman.
Each solemnly and sincerely swear that you will support the Constitution of the United States, that you will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the state of North Carolina and to the constitutional powers and authorities which are or may be established for the government thereof, and that you will endeavor to support, maintain, and defend the Constitution of said state, not inconsistent with the Constitution of the United States, to the best of your knowledge and ability. If so, so help me God.
So help me God.
And finally, would you please state your name once more?
James Fred Bowman.
David Andrew Lindley.
Do you swear that you will well and truly execute the duties of the Office of Alamance Soil and Water Conservation District Supervisor according to the best of your skill and ability, according to law, so help me God?
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Now we'll do public comments. Thank you, Judge Lambert.
Thank you
very
much.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We'll start with Jeremy Teeter.
Okay, I hope I find you, ladies and gentlemen, doing well this evening. Congratulations on your recent victories. I know it was definitely hard-earned because I was out there campaigning right beside you, so I know how hard it was. I just want to start. I'm here tonight to recognize Ann Vaughn for her service on the County Commission. I first met Ms. Vaughn while I was a student teacher out at Western Alamance High School, which, as many of you know, is her old stomping ground. And I was teaching world history, and One day I heard some sort of murmuring through the school that she was going to be coming to do a tour and a visit. And at this point in time, I'd already announced that I was going to be running for county commission, but I didn't say if I was going to go for a 4-year seat or a 2-year seat. And I said, surely she's coming and she's going to pop in the door and intimidate me from creating a primary for her and creating a big mess for the 4-year seat. I just knew that was coming. But I was surprised. She really didn't talk about politics when she came. And she actually ended up developing to be a good teacher mentor of sorts. And she had 37 years of experience that I could lean on and really sort of bounce ideas with her. She had actually taught with my cooperating teachers, so she was ended up being a very good resource. Later on, after the student teaching experience was over, I actually learned that I had student taught her granddaughter the entire semester and had no clue that she was in my classroom because the last names are completely different. And I think Ann knew all along that I was teaching her granddaughter but didn't want to say anything because she didn't know how favorable I would be grade-wise if I knew that. So that was a professional ever. But I can say that, you know, I learned a lot about Ann's career as a teacher while I was out at Western. I spent some time thumbing through the yearbooks and talking to old colleagues. And, you know, and from what I can best ascertain, she was a phenomenal teacher of American government and civics, always finding a way to get her students encouraged to be involved and civically engaged, and just a phenomenal advocate. She eventually started to practice what she preached. She became a frequent visitor of county commission meetings, writing letters to the editor, and eventually, after 2 tries, made her way to the county commission herself. And I can tell you that as an educator who is also involved in politics and is also a teacher of American government, ironically, it really does a lot for your students and for the young people to see that one of their mentors and someone that they look up to is actually getting involved in these sorts of things. So it really goes a long way. But with that note, some of the notable things that I've observed over her career, and she was one of the first people that I actually voted for because, you know I'm very young, and my first election was actually that election in 2006. So I was 18 years old for that election. And I noticed the thing that really stood out to me was that she made local government more accessible to the citizens of Alamance County. Number one, through the televised meetings. It made it so easy for people to just either log on or turn on their television at night and see exactly what's going on. And in fact, that's a tool that I'm using in my classroom today. My students actually just completed a county commissioner simulation where they had to sort out the budget, and I let them actually see some model county commissions work through their own issues, and it really gave them a good groundwork to build on. So it's really had some educational benefits that maybe the board is not aware of. Also, I would say that she's just truly conducted herself as a professional, and as a result of this hard work, she has actually become the recipient of 3 awards for her public service, which I actually intercepted from her granddaughter, who I've stayed in contact with since the student teaching experience. And if I could just go ahead and have Ann to come up. And I've left them in the wrapping to try to protect them here. The first one is from the Elite American Publishers, and they recognize Ann Vaughn for outstanding accomplishments in the field of public service, and they say thank you for your dedication and commitment to excellence. And this one is actually signed by Donald Trump Jr. All right, so this is commendable. That's a present for Mr. Trump.
Tim, this is the deer in the headlights you always talk about, okay?
Okay, the next one was actually accompanied with a letter and a plaque, and this is from Cambridge Who's Who, and it says, Cambridge Who's Who recognizes Ann Vaughn as a professional of the year representing public service. The above-named individual has been selected for our top honor for the 2010-2011 edition of the Cambridge Who's Who Registry of Executives, Professionals, and Entrepreneurs. Okay, there's your letter. Placing there. It's a very nice plaque. Mm-hmm. Okay,
did
and
you get this from her?
We had to be real serious. It wasn't easy.
Die.
It was. And the third one is from Who's Who's National Honor Society, and they recognize Ann Gardner Vaughn for exemplary contributions to the national standards of professionalism within the field of government. All right, so definitely. So 4 years of hard work definitely paid off.
Thank you. Thank you. I don't know what to say. I'm just speechless at this point, but thank you so much. Right. And thank you, folks.
And thank you for your time.
Thank you. Congratulations. Yeah.
Okay, the next one is John Oakes.
Commissioners, good evening. John Oakes, Burlington. Congratulations to Mr. Lashley, Mr. Sutton on your reelections, and to Mr. Manning for being our newly elected commissioner. I believe that the message that was sent to all elected officials at the local, state, and national level this last election is simple and sincere. We as a community require that our elected representatives not only listen to us, but most importantly, adhere to the macro reasons, the big picture, when you're casting your votes. Those issues are simple. First and foremost, adhere to reducing the size of government at all levels. Eliminate debt by reducing spending, not by raising our taxes. Spend less than we take in at all levels of government, even if that means cutting programs or eliminating programs. Reality-based decision-making, not dreamland. Next, stay out of micromanaging our free enterprise system in America. Do this by limiting government's role and involvement to only regulating business so as to keep out and punish the crooks. If you do this, you'll be rewarding, the doers and makers, not the complainers that are typically the takers in our society. We as a nation are fast approaching more takers than doers, if we haven't already passed that point. Our country was established by doers, not by groups or individuals who live in a hypothetical, imaginary world, but by determined individuals and groups that were and are committed to doing something each and every day in order to improve their lives and their families' lives, which in turn typically improved everyone's life. Yes, there are exceptions to that rule, but they are by far the exception, not the norm. That is an historical fact, and I encourage everyone, commissioners, people in the audience, to spend the time, energy, and effort it takes to become informed of these facts. Finally, have the will and conviction to resolve the problem of legal and illegal immigration. Start by immediately using your influence with state and federal representatives to secure our state and national borders. Respectfully, I believe how each of you votes on issues will be the measure by which rational and decent people will believe you, trust you, and respect you. I would encourage each of you to remember your vote will be the barometer that will help us determine what you truly believe when making decisions on behalf of the community. I'm almost done. I'll offer you this simple example when voting on issues that I said to my sons when they were growing up. Remember, rational people will judge you based on your actions, not your words. So your words only have meaning if they are in agreement with your actions. Politicians base their voting decisions on what is in their best interest. A true representative bases their voting on what is in the best interest of the average citizen, the little guy. I encourage each of you to always choose to make decisions with the courage of a true representative and not a career politician. I, along with all rational people of goodwill, sincerely wish each of you wisdom, knowledge, as you take the realm of this entrusted leadership role in our community, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak to you publicly this evening. Good luck to all of you. Thank you.
Next is Lawson Graham. There you are. I lost you for a minute.
I get lost probably more than I should. It's my pleasure to be before you tonight. I'm Lawson Brown, practice law with the Vernon Law Firm, Alamance County Law Firm for 80-plus years. I'm speaking on behalf of Mebane 8540 LLC and Tanger Piedmont LLC, which is the Tanger Factory Outlet Center. As we have articulated and stated, and I'm reiterating again tonight, we believe that the inclusion of these two properties in Alamance County is consistent with Senate Bill, Session Bill 2010-61. Take just a second to read the one Section 8 that I think is applicable. Alamance County and Orange County shall cause areas of the boundary line to be resurveyed in areas where property owners have met the established administrative criteria to be assigned to a specific county, and that's the residential. The Section 8 goes on to say, and in areas where for practical or other reasons in the North Carolina geodetic survey line is not reasonable or is unduly burdensome. We think that there clearly are two separate areas of property to look at, the residential that are handled by the specific criteria that were handled administratively. Second, the area, and in areas where for practical or other reasons the North Carolina geodetic survey line is not reasonable. Mr. Craig Benedict from Orange County articulated some 13 reasons that his staff, after studying this for the 2+ years, believes that it is unduly burdensome and not reasonable to have that included in Orange County. And basically, it boils down to safety issues. I understand I have 3 minutes, and I don't want to belabor that, but I wanted to emphasize again to you, as we have done throughout this process, that we believe that it's appropriate that these properties be included in Alamance County. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Next is Ed Shue. You're not going to do that? Okay. Well, then we are through with the public comments. Okay. Thank you. Okay, the next on our agenda is commissioners' responses to any of these comments.
No response.
Okay. We have no response. We'll go to number 12, the Code of Ethics Policy, which is Clyde Albright, County Attorney.
Good evening.
Good evening.
The state of North Carolina passed a law last year to require all cities, counties, local boards of education, sanitary district, to adopt a code of ethics for the governing board and to require the members of those governing boards to receive education on ethics laws applicable to local government. And you have before you a proposed code of ethics for Alamance County, North Carolina. This code is based on a model that the School of Government had put together many years ago in the book by Fleming Bell. Since the law was passed, several other counties and cities have entered into a similar code of ethics. And pretty straightforward. One thing I wanted to point out to you was that the law doesn't have an enforcement provision, but the proposed code of ethics does. The proposed code of ethics has a censure provision beginning on page 4. I'll be glad to try and answer any questions you may have.
I got one, Clyde. On the thing where I think Linda, myself, and Ann went to the code of ethics class already, is that what's the?
You have to attend that class.
By January
1
or something.
By January
1
of
2011. Yeah. Okay. Just curious. I wasn't sure about that part of it.
Did you have to?
That's in Section 7 of the.
I did. Does that apply what I did through the Board of Education?
Yes. Yeah,
we went.
I have not been.
Tim.
You have to have your initial training.
We actually had a webinar here.
Yes, we did.
And for the county, and I was out of town, and I went to another county to do mine. So,
right.
But I don't know. You may want to get with Tori or Pat before and find out where.
Because that's state law, right?
It is.
We do
where you
to do
have
that.
To go to get there, okay? Anybody got any questions on this?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Budget amendments.
Madam Chair,
yes, I'm sorry. We need to
motion.
I'll make a motion. Do I hear second?
Second.
All in favor? That's good. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. Thank you.
I don't know, but we got a choice to oppose it. If it's state law, we don't have a choice.
That's right. So, Okay, the next thing is the budget amendments for the Health Department, Mr. Baskin. There he is.
Madam Chairman, Commissioners, congratulations to our newly elected or re-elected officials and on your re-election as our chairperson.
Thank you.
We have four budget amendments for you all to have for your consideration tonight. All these have very specific purposes, which are outlined. The first one, budget amendment number 52, is specifically for sterilization services. And these will be, these is $8,000 that will be used towards primarily tubal ligations. They also can be used towards vasectomies. So again, these will be for patients who that we see that are in need of these services.
We want to do these individually?
We can. It may be the easiest way.
Easiest way. Do I hear a motion to accept this budget amendment, please?
So moved.
I have a motion. I need a second.
Second.
I have a second. All those say aye.
Aye.
All opposed.
The next one is from the Division of Public Health and Chronic Disease and Injury Prevention. And as you all may recall, I was here a few months ago. We also had the same is from my Asthma Coalition. And this is for asthma prevention and community awareness. And these funds will be used primarily in conjunction with our relationship with ABSS, looking for asthma education with child care providers and their curriculum for asthma and teaching parents about asthma. Also, we will be using to purchase an additional 15 of the coded bags on, you know, for the air quality awareness, the different codes, and to know the codes that we also be using, like for billboards. And also part of that initiative is the anti-idling program that is going on for the schools where folks don't sit and idle, creating air pollution. And then finally, the air quality index curriculum for our school teachers. So these will all be used for community education and community awareness around asthma.
Do I hear a motion to accept this grant?
So moved.
Motion?
Second.
On the favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. The next one is for $3,636 from the immunization program. We will be using these funds to look for activities, for example, with our the North Carolina Immunization Registry, as well as like pertussis kits and other educational, community education about vaccine preventable diseases to the public.
Barry, are they doing, you still doing the flu shots too?
Yes, sir. As a matter of fact, we now have them at the end of the flu, at the end of the vaccination season, we're giving away at no cost now.
Okay.
So if anyone has the need, we've got
it don't hurt vaccines.
It doesn't hurt much. Shouldn't hurt at all, but you know, no guarantee.
I make a motion to approve this.
Thank you. I have a motion on the floor.
Second.
I have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay.
And the last of the budget amendments is for $4,585. And I was looking down at the body of it, and it's not for contractions. It says it's for long-acting reversible contractions in the body of the letter, and that should be contraception. That's a little bit of a difference there. And these funds are specifically for reducing the need for abortion as well as high-risk pregnancies in ladies. We will use this to purchase Depo-Provera as well as Implanon and intrauterine devices for pregnancy prevention.
Second. I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you very much. Appreciate
Barry,
it.
Before you leave, let me ask you a question, please. I read an article in Greensboro News Record about Rockingham County claiming, or not them, but an analysis of their county that they were, their access to medical care was very low in the state. In other words, the article's gist was clearly that Rockingham County didn't have enough areas for people to turn to for medical care, okay? And I think they were ranked, I mean, low, like 80th, 90th or something. Are you familiar with that survey?
I would assume that those are the county rankings. They're coming back out again this year, yes, sir.
All right, how are we ranked in that?
We're ranked within like the top 30, I believe. I have to get back with you on that and check, but in terms of access to care, we are ranked much higher, yes, sir.
I'd like to see those rankings.
Okay, yes, sir.
If you
will. To you.
And I pulled off the email of the State of the County health report that you did send us, and yes, congratulations. There are several areas where we're below the state average in certain arenas. But would you comment on something? about what we're doing in our county from the health department and/or other arenas that you're familiar with about substance abuse. Page 7, it said, y'all don't have this, I don't believe, unless you pulled it off. I got it off the email that you sent us. Alcohol prevention, underage drinking.
Yes, sir, and we are working with our community partners on that. There's a substance abuse task force currently here in Alamance County looking, and that's one of the issues. So very active in looking at work. The sheriff's department's very active in that, along with our other community partners with mental health, and trying to address that issue.
Well, I wish, you know, I'm with teenagers every day, practically, over Guilford County, and I've been with several, many in Alamance County, and they will tell you a whole lot if you just sort of talk to them. And some of the stories that I hear of parties at people's houses with 30 kids, I mean, I heard a story where when the police were called, this is in Alamance County, when the police were called and came to the house, the kids ran from the house, and one girl ran into a tree and broke her nose or something. And the parents were coming and complaining about, you know, being their children being forced to take breathalyzers and so forth. But I don't think the story is out there as to how easy alcohol is for these children to get in our community, in our county, and elsewhere in Guilford. And, you know, I've seen, you know, scenes of where kids wrap their car around a tree. I mean, there's a case in Greensboro where three kids died in Brown Summit. Four of them were in a car, and the girl driving took the curve, a 40-mile-an-hour curve at 90 miles an hour, split the car in two. All of them were over .20 in alcohol. And the girl's going to prison for it, and they were beautiful kids. One of the girls that died worked at Plato's, which is where they sell designer clothes, and other kids come in and buy them. Beautiful girl. One girl was on the wrestling team at one of the high schools. And these kids have access to alcohol at their will. And I just hope we can do more to prevent that and expose it too.
Yes, sir. And especially like we're with our schools, but I think you'll see a concerted effort to get that information, that word out. It's a very important public health issue. So.
Tim, you know, we do have a group of girls that came
from they did.
Williams High School, mm-hmm. and they've also been to a couple other places that I have been during this past year, and I forgot the name of the group.
They were out of Williams High School.
They were out of Williams High School, and it was a couple from Cummings with them, too. And because I wanted to know why all the schools weren't involved in it, and they said they just couldn't get anybody, you know, to come with them from the other schools. I think it was just Cummings and Williams,
they
if
could
I'm not
start
mistaken.
Each high school, and Tom might be able to comment on this, and I hate to belabor this point, but if it saves one life, it's worth it. I brought in a guy at Northwest Guilford to speak to one of my classes from Raleigh, and he was one of the North Carolina's regional people on Mothers Against Drug Driving. And he put on a program like you would not believe. And my comments to the children or to the kids were, you need to start a Mothers Against Drunk Driving chapter here in your high school. You can do it. It's just a matter of doing it, learning how to do it, and get the recognition for it, get your picture in the annual, get your picture of your club, and push those concepts. And there's tools out there we can use, I just don't think we use. And it breaks my heart to see where a kid has died drunk.
Yes, sir. And there are challenges there, yes, sir.
Because it could have been mine.
Absolutely.
Or yours.
Thank you. Okay, next is the Orange County, Alamance County line discussion. Mr. Albright and Mr. Walker, if you will come forward, please.
Here we are again. We have reached, I think, the end of the process after 4 years of hard work. Both boards have considered and voted on and agreed on a criteria. We did that earlier this year. Having listened to residents who were complaining about being moved from one county where they believe they always were located, but as part of the location of the line by the Geodetic Survey. So this board and the Orange County Board considered and voted on and agreed to a process. And the staff in Alamance County, the staff in Orange County, sat down and deliberately began looking at this map. Bruce will show you more of these maps. to develop a criteria that would work. And we did that, and the emphasis was on the fairness of the process. That's what we were told to do by this board, make this process fair. It started with the Ninth Street folks, so that's what we looked at. And we came up with a criteria, taking into consideration the wishes of the affected citizens, as expressed by them in the many public meetings that Bruce Walker and I have attended, and the many phone calls that he's taken. I haven't taken quite as many, but we developed a criteria. And both boards agreed to it. We feel it's a good criteria. And I want to remind you of three things. We went to Raleigh, and we got a local bill to allow us to do this, to allow us to make these small changes to the line. And this local bill confers no rights on any taxpayer. Section 7 of the local bill authorizes both boards to develop a method and criteria to make this transition of the geodetic survey line less harsh on certain of our citizens. And I believe that's what we've done. The required petitions have been prepared. They've been mailed out. They've been returned. We've got 49 petitions back on a 26-mile line. That's not bad. Notices were sent out to everybody. They responded. Section 8 of the bill you've heard tonight includes language that talks about unduly burdensome. Well, the reason that language is put in that bill, and I know because I drafted it, was because the Cane Creek section of the southern section of both counties creates a geographical anomaly. So we had to have some kind of language in there to say that putting a line through a proposed development is unduly burdensome is really quite disingenuous when you look at a 2007 map and the assumed line in 2007 cuts through the same development. So, having said that, I feel like you need to concentrate on the criteria, fairness to the people that have received these petitions, that have filled them out in good faith and returned them to us. Secondly, we've got to follow the local law to the letter. And I believe that we've done that in this case. Thirdly, there have been no problems that I'm aware of with the EMS, the sheriff, the Fire Protective Services, based on the assumed county line. And that's the line that the geodetic survey corrected. So I'm at a loss as to what the unduly burdensome and unreasonable problems now present themselves and why. It seems to me that if we don't stick to this position and this criteria, we're going to place ourselves in a very tenuous position. Because if you allow someone at this late date to change the criteria, where do you stop it? And who makes that decision? Bruce and I can't make that decision. So who makes that decision? Tossing aside the criteria would most certainly require us to start this preparation and mailing the new letters. Our local bill has a December 15th deadline to get these petitions in and approved. So if you take that approach, you're going to be ignoring the rights of people that have sent the petitions in, and you're going to be allowing other people to come in that have not been part of the process. So I believe in simplicity. I think we've adopted a criteria. Both boards have deliberated it and voted on it. Petitions have gone out. We need to stick to the course, take the petitions that have come in, do the surveys, and present the surveys to the General Assembly in accordance with Section 9 of the law. Now, I will tell you that Gaston and Lincoln County are in the midst of a similar situation. I spoke with the geodetic survey folks, and they have been offered a free-for-all approach, for lack of a better term, to decide what county they want to be in. They are recombining property so fast the surveyors can't keep up with the line. So I don't want to advise you to follow that path. I want you to stick to the letter of the law and the criteria of this local bill, accept these petitions, and let's move on and submit it to the General Assembly. And I'll turn it over to Bruce.
So can I ask a question?
Yeah, of course.
When we were in Mebane, and we agreed to to accept the 9% as well, is that, can you explain that?
That was on the condition that the Orange County taxpayers and board indemnify this board for any legal liability,
okay,
including damages.
Okay.
And that offer has been withdrawn.
Okay.
So I can't advise this.
By them?
Yes. I can't advise this board to go forward with that type of personal liability. And I think there's a possibility out there that it may occur. You heard Mr. Hoffenmeyer? Is that his name, Mr. Hoffenmeyer? He was one of the citizens who had a petition that he had completed, and it was summarily ignored. And he was upset. He was at the meeting last Monday.
Right.
You also have other folks that are along that line that have not been given the opportunity to move because they don't meet the criteria, which is a residence in the 150-foot strip and traditionally being taxed in the county. So if you open it for one, I think you're going to have to open it for others. And I just, what it really does effectively is start the whole process.
Well, the reason I said that, I've had emails this week, and everybody's had them, from Mill Creek now, that because their neighbors are going in, they want to be in Alamance County. I've had them from Mar Mill, because their neighbors are going in, they want to be in Alamance County. I've had them from, what'd you tell me, not Cottonwood.
Some Collington Farms. And
yeah, Collington Farms.
Individual landowners and people.
And I've had emails, phone calls, and a letter this long from a lady that thinks that she should be in Alamance County. So it's kind of escalating, and I want Mr. Benedict to know, too, who is here from Orange County. You know, this thing is escalating at this point due to the fact that some of these people are getting special privileges, evidently, that they think that they're not getting. And so, and I have had, I've sent all of them to Bruce. I still have them on my computer. So I have forwarded them to him because his name wasn't on them.
Well, that's why we developed the criteria, right, to avoid that type of problem.
Okay.
And it was deliberately done and tested. And we went from a 500-foot criteria to a 50-foot criteria to a 100-foot. And Bruce actually tested it all up and down the line based on the properties.
Orange County.
So it was a deliberate process, and we thought about it, put a lot of time and effort into it, to avoid this type of fairness issue. Because we want to treat all our citizens the same way. And all our folks on 9th Street that the board told us to accommodate, we have done that. And we have a rational reason for it. Well, if they were taxed and traditionally taxed in Alamance County,
in Alamance County,
and they're within that strip, right, then that
and that strip is 150 foot.
On either 150
side. Yeah. On either
side. On either side.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right.
Well, may I ask a question, Clyde?
Yes.
I attended the meeting at the Mevin Arts Center. Mm-hmm. If this board does agree to vote for the 91%, what happens if Orange County does not, or have they already?
Well, that's an interesting question, because what the statute says is that, and I'll just make sure we're going to grab the bill. It says that you agree and submit your survey to the General Assembly. Section 9, upon conclusion of the survey and petition process, which we're talking about now, no later than May 15, 2011, I'd ask you that. Orange and Alamance County shall submit to the North Carolina General Assembly for ratification a completed survey that includes both the North Carolina Geodetic Survey line, the baseline, that both boards agreed to in 2008, and all mutually agreed upon modifications thereto. So both boards have to agree on these modifications. So if this board votes to agree, 9th Street folks, modifications, and the other, 49 total modifications.
47 elements.
Then you submit that to Orange County. If Orange County agrees on those 49 modifications, then we send that down to Raleigh.
Which does not include the other 9%.
Does not include the other 9%.
But Tom's question is, as I had asked Craig myself earlier, this week, or yesterday, today, whenever, last week, of course, I'm voting geodetic straight line. I'm not voting for the zigzag. But if this board decides to go with the 91%, and Orange County balks and says, well, you're not giving us the 9%. I understand they want more now than what that 9% was. It's what I've been told.
There have been changes. From our meeting last Monday night, Mora Mill, there's some areas south and north of that area that I think the percentage has gone up even more. That, you know, both boards at that time did say, please take a look to see if that could be part of any type of agreement.
I think you heard that correctly also at that meeting.
Right. But I think the question has come, you know, the other areas, the people who weren't at the meeting who are giving you phone calls and calling staff as well. So that's where, you know, where do we make that break at is kind of our question to the board.
It's
only the mutually agreed upon.
So Orange County probably would agree on the 91%.
Right.
They just want additional.
That's where both staffs agreed. We got to that point. And then in October, mid-October, Orange County introduced that 9% addition. When you say the 91%, if you guys agreed to just the petition process, it would be 100%. Okay. But, you know, now it's broken out into 91%, what we agreed upon then with the petition process, and a 9% what Orange County's introduced at this point. We got those maps up there, and I got every map you ever wanted to see times two if you want to see it, and all the latest versions have been coming in. But
the statute that Clyde read said whatever we mutually agree
absolutely
on.
Absolutely
agreed to.
So it needs to be 100%.
Both counties can
agree. We get a lot of rhetoric here. If we don't vote, forgive me, rhetoric. If we don't vote, if the majority of this board does not vote for more than the 91, just the 91, and Orange County says, no, we're not going to go with just what you want. We want this amount, and we're going to vote no, then it's back to geodetic. Is that not correct?
That's correct.
That's right. So I hope, I'll challenge the rest of the board here, I hope you're not going to give in to Orange just because we're not going to get a certain portion of our soft.
But I would ask you to remember the folks on 9th Street. We have sent the petitions out. They have signed them in good faith.
And
we
they did what this board directed.
They did what the board directed.
I think this board's done what they're supposed to do.
They played by the rules. They did everything they were supposed to do. And so this new part, again, we were willing to listen to it. We heard it. I have the maps. I have the result maps that have come since then. Craig is here. He can talk about it.
Yeah, that'd be nice.
You know, you know, I put these up here to show you where it's come and where it's gone. And so we need a direction from the board. What do we send back to Orange County? Do we send them back a, you know, we agree to this and then maybe a counter, but we do have till the 15th, again, toward the law.
But, and I don't mean to belabor this, but.
Make a motion.
But we do have an agreement for what that 91% was. I mean, Orange County, they just want more than that.
Right, that's right.
Okay, so isn't that...
Or they want to give up more than that is actually...
Right, okay. Yeah. So really the options are, the line is the line, the 91%, or what would be 100%.
91 plus 9.
Right.
Plus more than 9.
Yeah.
91 plus more than 9, right?
Well, it's probably more than that now.
Okay, that's what I'm saying. Okay, go ahead.
Well, like Chairman Manson said, we've been inundated with new requests. I heard at the meeting that now we can do this and do that. And, you know, we've talked about opening up Pandora's box, and we don't know if necessarily that's true or not. But this is open discussion. I've got the results from them. They've given us a resolution where basically we can attach a map to it. Okay. We got that, I think, late last week, so it may or may not be part of your packet. Certainly can go over these, and again, you know, going back to the history again, that's the part where we went through the whole petition process. You know, we have the maps in the presentation. The 9% is what they introduced on the 29th. Then there was 9 people that spoke. 5 of those people were new additions to that 9%. Okay. And then since then, we've had at least 10 plus or more people making new requests saying, I heard this, I heard I can do this, and that kind of thing. So based on the direction from the board, you know, I've got the maps right here to show you the results of that. You know, we're open to discussion on that. So,
do we want to hear from Mr. Benedict?
Basically, we're here to answer questions related to that night, and we, you know, we need a direction moving forward. Do we want to go with what we agree with over the summer? Did you like what you heard on the 29th collectively as a board? Do you want to go forward with that? Do you want to include those people who spoke up that night? Do you want to include, I mean, again, you can see the slippery slope there where we set some rules and now we're kind of deviating from it. And again, referring to Clyde, you know, whenever we start treating people different, that's where we open ourselves liability-wise, and I'm going on that you, information.
Excuse me for having to say this. How long have we been in this situation?
I know.
How long?
Well, we met.
15 years.
Yeah, I met
with.
You've
done it 10 years.
With down
at all, I'm gonna say over 15. This is, hopefully, we can get it right. I mean,
I'm
people have put faith in the government that they've been paying their taxes to, and I think it's right that we at least respect the part. You know, they put faith that we were doing the right thing. Clyde, you throw back that we're gonna get sued and this and that and the other. How many suits have we had?
We haven't had any yet.
Over tax issues, because we've been that line has been like that for years.
But it's been an agreement between Orange County and Alamance,
and that's what it is today. And it's what we're working towards. And
the ones that do exist did not go well.
It's a legal document now that we have to do what that legal document tells us we can do, and nothing more.
But if we can't agree as two boards, it doesn't matter.
If there's 150 foot, and that document it says it's 150 foot. Legally, we got to stick to that 150 foot, or we're going to be sued. I don't want to be sued for something that we do that's unlawful. I believe the people deserve our respect.
I agree with you that, but we need to get it right. That's all I'm saying.
May I say, interject?
They've been taxed. They, you know, for the last 40 years.
This process has not been behind closed doors. We've had numerous public meetings. The developers and the folks that you've heard from tonight certainly could have come. Back in June and said we want to be included in part of this criteria that you're developing, and it didn't happen. So it's parachuting in at the last hour. It throws a monkey wrench into the process. And a lot of these folks that, as I've mentioned tonight, have been involved in this as long, well, I've been involved in it for almost 4 years now. But I know Ms. Robbins from the first meeting when we talked about this. And we've gotten to know her. A nice lady,
sure she
and
is.
She has legitimate concerns, and she convinced this board and the Orange board to set up this criteria in this fashion. And now you're being asked to ignore that, to add some more people in, and we really don't have a measuring stick to tell us when it ends. When does it end? Do you add somebody down south that wants to include his farm in that's beyond the 150-foot strip? What's the answer to that question if you throw the criteria away? So that's why we developed the criteria.
So if we stick to the criteria, we'll only do the 91%. Is that what you're saying?
Well, you're saying it's 100% based on the petition process. That would be your stopping point.
Okay.
If you go to the 9% that they presented, those additional 9%, then that's your 100%. I mean, these are various 100%. So if you stick with what you did over the summer and say, you know, this Orange County recommendation to both boards, which again we had no problem them, you know, presenting it, had to convince you that was a good thing to do, then you decide on that. But you know, we're hoping for a consensus on the board moving forward. Where do we need to go?
And so it's either the 91
or the 9%
petition process,
or
the 90,
add the 9%,
add 100%, or
right.
And we, it's always 100%. We got to have 100%. We can't take a less than 100% to the state. They won't,
right.
You know.
So, and if we don't do that, where are we left? Because if
start all over again.
It basically defaults. I mean, the state came in, and when Clyde initially talked about this, you know, the commissioners on both sides asked the state, can you come in and tell us where the line is? There have been places where they come in, not enough evidence, we can't do that. They defend their procedures, their state agency and courts, okay? And so they came in and gave us a line. And so, and then that's when we said, okay, we're actually supposed to be taxing based on that by law already. The local bill allowed us the opportunity to work together and get some kind of resolution, because
right.
It was very, very important last November.
Mm-hmm.
you guys had said, we want to help these people, 9th Street people. We're listening, and we want to try to come up with a set of rules that would help the majority of people that were affected
and,
are being moved.
And we did just that for you. And to come in at the 11th hour with a new set of criteria, a new set of rules, as it were, it's unfair because the statute, the local bill, gives us to the 15th of December to do this.
That's eight days.
It's a little unsettling. When we could have addressed this possibly back in June of this year had we known about it.
So would you like for Mr. Benedict to make comments?
I would like to hear from him.
And I have the maps from the 9th that we can go over those. I mean, again, I gave you the packet. We didn't have the PowerPoint presentation because we got it at 4:30 on the last day. I want to make sure you had all those materials. If you have specific questions, we can pull those up. I mean, it's basically where do you want to go?
Okay. So maybe Mr. Benedict, if you want to come forward, please.
Excuse me, a little cold. I was out playing in the snow this weekend. My name is Craig Bennett, Orange County Planning Director. I thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. 77% NCGS line, we're in agreement with that straight line for a large portion of it. 14% was criteria, administrative criteria, that was jointly developed by both boards, agreed to. They submitted petitions. The 9% that Orange County was asking for did meet the administrative criteria, not new criteria. They met the 150-foot boundary. They just did not send their petition in. Why did they not send the petition in? I do not know. Did they want to? Did they think if they didn't send the petition in, they stayed in the same county they've been in the past? That may be the case. But this is not new criteria, the 9% from Orange County. It meets the petition criteria. 26 people that we sent petitions to did not submit. We had another 20 that did. And also the local bill that was stated, Session Law 61-2010, did give the boards of both commissions the opportunity to make judgments other than the administrative criteria. And that's where the case of those yet undeveloped property, where the line could be unreasonable. The local bills did not have that 150-foot mark in there. That was something that we developed outside of that local bill. So in the opportunities of the Tanger outlet, where all of the lands would go into Alamance County, the Medmen 8540 LLC, yet undeveloped, that all goes into Alamance County also. Instead of leaving that line straight for the future, having development continue and end up splitting some new houses or new hotels or new restaurants, we thought we have the opportunity with this new local bill in 2011 to redefine the line. And if we redefine the line, there would be not likely lawsuits because you are now, the legislature has the opportunity to redefine the line, and that's what we're asking to try to accomplish. We're not coming in at that extra amount of people that spoke at the public hearing, and the changes that came forward were in joint agreement by this board and the commissioners. That's not another Orange County initiative. That was where people spoke at the public hearing. The Howard Miller area, the Shopler, Piefer, people that spoke at the public hearing, and the Scarlet Lane Village of the Oaks Pride. Those were two that were jointly agreed to. That's why we brought it forward. There was a third area, and I guess this is where, you know, when do you stop? You know, and if you want to just work with those two areas, the Village of the Oaks, Scarlet Lane area, where Mrs. Lambert spoke and said, let's just include that cul-de-sac where you're going from one county and going into another county. You just want to include that, that's fine. And if you want to just include the Piefer Howard, you know, subdivision down there off of Morrow Mill that was spoke about at the public hearing and kind of in consensus agreed to, that's fine. The other area on the east side of Morrow Mill Road that we thought there was some interest in researching and bringing something forward that made sense, if you're not ready for something like that, then maybe another 161 years from now, you know, somebody else can address that. I think that the proposal that both staff has worked very hard on and the public has provided a lot of input, and the Joint Commissions met November 9th of last year, November 29th of this year, have done some some really yeoman work to get this far with it. I would love to be able to offer 100% to the legislature this year in consensus and move forward. The line would eventually be the new line that is determined by the legislature. So I look forward to coming to terms with a lot of the discussion that we had here tonight. But I think the 77%, the 14% petitions, and the 9% that the was suggested last week, and then just those two projects, if you think that was what you heard presentations on by the general public, if you think that's complete enough, then that would be fine with us, most likely.
And if we don't think that, then what do you think?
It, if
because like I said, I've been inundated with all these people emailing me, and we want this to happen.
Yeah.
We do want this to happen.
But
you know, we thought that was all it was. The 9 and the 91.
Couple projects.
And now here comes some more in.
I think if you went with the 9% and then just the people that spoke at the public hearing, that would be.
Is that the 9%?
That's 9% plus those two groups of people that spoke at the meeting.
Because I had people to say we didn't know about a meeting.
Yeah.
So they weren't there.
Well,
so what do you do with those people?
There
mean,
was.
You know, that's what I'm saying.
I did speak
it's
with
just
people
really
from.
Escalating. Yeah. You know, it's just escalating.
You know,
so.
I spoke with a lot of people, as did the Alaman staff, and I said we cannot. We're not going to make it work for everybody.
No,
you know, and the Mill Creek area, you know, for some sense it does. Makes sense to have it all in Alamance County, but I said we can't resolve that in this go around. So let's try to fix the 100% as we know it now, or as we'll propose it. And then if we ever have the initiative to tackle this again in other areas, and that'd be for another staff or another board, who knows. But I think the 100% that was suggested the other night, plus the two public hearing groups that spoke, is a achievable achievable recommendation. Thank you for being able to talk.
Thank you.
I'd like to ask Bruce or Clyde, will you comment on his statement?
Sure. That's what
that
I
mean. The 9% is within the parameters that y'all set forth.
Well, first of all, he said that the petitions that weren't sent in, he's included them. So someone made a conscious decision not to send the petition in, and now they're going to be moved. So that doesn't meet the criteria. The criteria is taxed in the county, get the petition, complete it, mail it in.
Okay, Bruce.
In discussing of the 9%, the people that there was five percent that met the criteria, and then there was a new criteria related to the hangar and the future development, because that didn't originally qualify based on that criteria. Is that correct?
If there was administrative criteria, then there's local bill criteria.
Right. He's referring to the local bill that unduly burdensome for that 4% for the development. The people that qualified were that other 5 or 4% of those neighborhoods that we looked at, and they were saying, let's put all of them in. I've got them. I can pull them up. So that's the clarification for that. So it's a breakdown. It's not all the 9%. It's 5 and 4%, to answer your question. I mean, you get all these numbers, you start throwing all these numbers out, it gets real confusing. But, you know, we were just trying to do everything fair. We're told to do it fair along the line. We're trying to do that. But we want to fulfill your wishes. We very much want to get this done. It needs to be a consensus on both sides.
That's true.
You know, and we're willing to do whatever you guys need to do. We're trying to tell you the risks. We'll do whatever you want us to do. But, you know, we'll answer any more questions on it, and maybe Craig might have a comment, I don't know, on this. But
Craig, could you comment on this?
Well, with respect to staff, and we've talked a lot about this additional 9%, you know, that didn't have the petition submitted. There are things there that do make sense and that we can live with if that would help move the process forward. Again, it goes back to being identified by Orange County that if there's a lawsuit that resulted with respect to that additional property that met the criteria but sort of didn't meet the criteria, then if somebody uses that as an argument, we're putting that back in Orange County's lap and saying, y'all do it. You know, y'all take care of any lawsuits resulting as somebody using this criteria. And if we could get the wording worked out on that, right now I think there's quite a couple of drafts that have gone back and forth.
Yes, they don't like my suggestion that they also pay any damages that are awarded against any individual commissioner that may be sued.
If we could work out the wording there and come to an agreement upon that, from staff's end to move this process forward, I believe, you know, if you look at some of the requests that Orange County staff has made, they're very reasonable.
The 91 and 9.
The 91 and 9.
There are
reasons behind
that. Makes sense.
And they do make sense, and we can understand and support that. But again, it goes back to opening up that Pandora's box. And if you're opening up that Pandora's box, we want to make sure that we're not liable. You know, that somebody else, you know, if they can argue that, well, you did it for one, you didn't do it for another, if we get sued over that, that would be Orange County's lawsuit and not ours.
Can we send that message back to Orange County?
We need to vote on something
to
get it
into
session.
Well, that's what I'm saying. But we will have a stipulation.
We have sent that message back.
I would like to make a motion.
Can we look at some maps first, please,
sure.
Bill?
Yeah.
Can you show us the map with the 91 only and the map with the 91 plus 9 and a map, if you've got it, of 91 plus 9 plus what else they're calling for?
Is that this?
Part of the original packet from last Monday had those large maps you can read. I mean, it's very difficult to read those. I can zoom in.
What's the first map?
Just expanding on what we were doing before is, hey, that's our tax situation.
That's the form of the four lists.
Yeah, zigzag. Then the state came in and said, here's what we have as the original line. And then the agreed criteria produced the third map in. Okay. November 29th, you saw the 9% orange recommendation. Exactly. And my point in making this large map, there's not much difference between them. I didn't put a map on that one because we literally got some requests coming in today. There was some changes offered by Orange County today that were different from last week. So that's been part of the problem is that, you know, we got to draw a line in the sand and say, that's it. You know,
And I think the 9% is it.
So, you know, and I can, again, we got zoomed in areas, results of, it's not working. So public speaker requests, okay? So we talked about this, okay? Mrs. Lambert, is that correct? Okay, she lives right there. It's as it stands now, purple, Alamance, orange. The petition process with one person petitioned to stay in orange, everybody else wanted to leave it the way it was. But she wants to come into Alamance. She's always been an Orange County taxpayer. And they make the recommendation to do this and go around the whole neighborhood because of, in that particular case, both sides of the street, and you tell me if I'm wrong, Craig, safety issues, access, that kind of thing. Now, the only caveat in full truth to them is that that was one person of three people that would be changed without notification. Okay. When we did even the 9%, we said, hey, you need to notify these people that this is coming up related to that. Those two neighbors don't know anything about what we're discussing today. They didn't get a letter for this new proposal. And we only got a few days. I'm just trying to tell you that she came, but her neighbors didn't come. We don't know their wishes. Okay. This is the property that was the Pfeiffer property. Okay. The three people of the five people showed up, and they also did the letter. You have a copy of that letter and the memo I gave you two months ago. Their houses are really far from the county line. They're currently Orange County residents, okay? They originally, you know, they had some questions on safety and how distance from fire districts. Fire districts are I went back and remeasured, it's 0.6 miles. They're definitely within fire district coverage. Area A and B has not signed that letter. What do we do for them? okay?
Would you take your pen and show where Mr. Pfeiffer's probably outlined it?
Mr. Pfeiffer's is this one here in his
and
house.
He, right and he there. Wants to remain in orange.
He wants to remain
so
in
orange. So how would you map that, Bruce?
Well, I mean, based on Orange County's recommendation would be take that property as well and put it all. It's currently orange. Keep it orange. Okay.
Mr. Schopler also petitioned.
Yeah, Mr. Schopler is this gentleman right here. Yeah, Mr. Pfeiffer and then Mr. Howard right here, if that's correct, Craig. And then there's another gentleman, I forget his name, owns this property. And another gentleman, they're both vacant, okay? So, but in full truth, not everybody signed that letter. It's not as cut and dry as and I was trying to tell you the whole story. There's their driveway, we mapped their driveway just to show you, and it comes right at the line where they come in. Access comes up through here or down through here. They are on the western side of Cane Creek, which the one criteria for that neighborhood was on the eastern side and landlocked, so there's some differences there. These are the fire stations and their location. And again, Swepsonville, I don't know how the fire stations would dispatch or how the districts would be created. I can't tell them that until it actually happens. But again, that would be how they access from probably that's the closest one in Alamance County, Swepsonville. So we did all, anybody who wrote us a letter today, we did all this analysis for every single one of them because it was, we take this very seriously. The Moore Mill Group, above them, again, this proposal came, and he's now, I guess, Craig's saying this is off the table maybe if that moves it forward. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. But this was a discussion of now, instead of both sides of the street being in one county, it would be split down by Moore Mill. There was a couple requests in there, but there was also a request that was glad to stay in, you know, to be in Alamance County. So, you know, and we don't know the rest of the people that would be included in this. We don't know their wishes or they have not been informed, okay, based on Monday's information. Mr. Heffenmeyer, he was the one gentleman who spoke. This is him right here. You know, he made it very clear that he was glad to have half of Alamance County rather than, you know, pay for all of Orange. The proposal came in this morning that we put him completely in Alamance. So those are the four, those are the five speakers that spoke. And again, depending on who you want to accommodate, whether it's just the Pfeiffers and Miss Lambert in that neighborhood, we certainly can go forward with that.
What about the Tanger section?
Tanger section? Those were part of the 9% proposal, okay? So that, even though they came and spoke, just like they just spoke tonight,
right.
That was part of the 9% proposal. Okay. So that's not a new proposal. I got lots of maps if you want to see. Go back. I can go back in time, and I have some of the maps that you had mentioned, because you asked where are those people coming from. But you know, obviously where we're at, so we need to get some direction. Any more questions related to the?
Bill, what's the most?
I'm so confused, man. It's
a good way to do government. That's for sure.
Well, the thing that I see is, you know, we agreed to look at, do the 9%, and the others were just thrown at us part of today. You know, and I'm like, Bill, I'm confused about it myself at this point. I was happy the other night when I left.
Right.
When I left Evan. I said, okay, you know, I think we can deal with the 9%, you know, but we would like to know that we're not going to be sued if we agree on this stuff.
So you would like to have a net under that?
I would like to have a net under that, and if we can get somebody to do that, then, you know, I think that I'm wondering if we need to table this for another.
I don't think we can. We can
table it and have a special meeting. You know, we could.
Well, we need to take care of this.
To ask a question of Clyde, and I'm sorry if this approaches the level
of being combative or contentious or whatever, but tonight and in the past, you've made it. You brought it forth about counties that are doing things like this. I mean, you know, you talk about the free-for-all quote. But why haven't we been told about the counties who have refused to entertain such, we opened Pandora's box back when we agreed to do this process. Geodetic line is the geodetic line. It's state surveys, it's approved professionally, and so forth and so on. And when we went past that, for whatever reason, justified or not emotionally, I think it's emotional more than anything, that's when Pandora's box was open. I'm sorry, but I'm a little disturbed that I had to discover that Franklin and Wake, the county of the state capital, they had the same debate. They had, and it was probably worse. And if we think that there weren't properties that were divided, even houses that were divided by the so-called county line, you know, I think we're missing all the points that are out there. And they sat back and said, we're not getting into this debate. The county line is the geodetic line. If your house is divided, you pay where the master bedroom, I mean, that's an old principle. Some people claim they've never heard it before. I've heard that all my life. The master bedroom is where you pay your tax for the house. The property, if the line is split in between one-thirds in one county, two-thirds is in another, you pay one-third of the county that the one-third's in, two-thirds to the county that the other side. Wake thought that was the way to solve this, and I have to believe their commissioners are sharp. I have to believe that Franklin County were sharp, and they came to that conclusion. Guilford County, you think there's no contentious areas over there? They're not going to move the county line. I guarantee you. The geodetic line is the line in Guilford, for Alamance and Guilford. It is in Wake and Franklin. But all of a sudden, we've acted like the whole state's doing this. Well, I have news for you. The whole state ain't doing this. I think they've refused to open Pandora's box.
But we agreed to do what
I understand that. Right. I got outvoted on this, and I'm willing to be outvoted 4-1. I'll stick to geodetic. But why weren't we told about that? That there were some normal operations with some other counties. They were not going to do all this.
I think the reason there are so few of them that are normal, as you say. The one situation I can immediately recall is the Mecklenburg Argyle situation, Lake Norman.
It's over water, though.
And over water, and the geographic issues there. And
I don't think so.
They run into the same problems in every county. They have many of these things going on right now in the state. But the straight line certainly is the easiest way to go.
Well, the geodetic line, it's not the fact that it's straight, it's that it's geodetic.
Right.
The line in Wake and Franklin, that line is not straight. That line is curved as it can be. But they just said we're not opening the Pandora's box. And I just don't think we were ever shown that there were many sides to this story other than just accommodating.
Well, one thing, Tim, case in point, though, both boards can agree on something that needs to be resolved.
I agree. They agreed
and
on GED.
We need to move forward.
That's fine. I'm ready to vote.
Madam Chair, can I
make a decision tonight? Okay. We need to resolve this now.
Let me try one.
Mr. Manning would like to make a motion.
I appreciate everything Clyde and Bruce and Craig have done. That's a lot of work. And 161 years is a long time to try to make correction here in the time y'all have. But I would like to make a motion to this board that we approve the 91% as recommended by our county attorney and as Mr. Walker has presented the facts. And in addition, that this board approve the additional 9% if the indemnification agreement can be worked out between our county attorney and Orange County. If it can, then fine. If not, then the motion is that the 91% be approved, and that's my motion.
I'll second that motion.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
No.
Okay. We'll carry. We hope it works.
thank you, Bruce.
We hope we can give and take a little here. Okay.
You can carry that back to your board and say you were witness.
Okay, county manager reports. And tell them we really want to do this, Mr. Benson. Okay.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a couple of reminders. Please do not forget Wednesday. This coming Wednesday at 7:30 a.m. is the annual county elected officials breakfast at ACC. That will begin at 7:30, and also after that, there is a groundbreaking ceremony for the new literacy building. So please make sure you stick around for that. But again, breakfast begins at 7:30 a.m. The county Christmas luncheon also will be held on Friday, February 17th, from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. at the Graham Rec Center.
February. You moved on ahead there.
I'm a day late and a dollar short. December 17th.
Okay. What time?
11 a.m. to 2 p.m.
The
Graham Rec Center.
December
17th at the Graham Rec Center.
At lunchtime?
Yes, sir.
12 o'clock?
Yes, sir. And also, we did not give you enough warning for this meeting, but if we could at our next meeting, take pictures of the board so that we can put on our website. So if we could do that directly after the meeting on the 20th.
All right. Okay, on the consent agenda, does anybody have anything to pull from that?
I'd like to pull B, the sheriff's salary. I just got a question on that.
That is number 16B.
16B.
I got it.
Is that the same salary you've been at, or is that with increase?
Sheriff.
That is his current salary.
That's no raise or anything?
No increase.
Oh, well. That's the way life is, isn't it?
We had to.
No, I was just curious. No, we weren't. We're going to take a little bit back, man.
Before the election, we had to set it back to the starting salary for the position, and then once the election is over, we put it back to existing salary.
Okay, so that's the existing. I knew it had been up and down a couple times. Wasn't sure about that. So.
And it's regrettable we can't give anybody an increase at this time, and because I would like to, but I can't. So.
Okay, just put that right back in.
Okay, so do I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda?
So moved.
Have a motion to accept. Have a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? No. Okay, the next thing is commissioner comments. Let me say one thing. Please read these. If you these appointments, if you have any questions with them, give me a call because we can change them, okay? And I'll be glad to give somebody. No, I'm kidding.
Linda, take a couple more, right?
No. No, I really enjoy what I'm doing, but and I've tried to be as fair as I could about this. So, but just give me a call. That's all I got to say.
I would like to make have the county commissioners make a resolution to ask the city of Burlington not to annex anybody out of the county into the city, because time will take care of a lot of things. There's no need and no rush to take people who do not want to be part of the city to be part of the city. People should have a right to remain in the county if they so desire.
Do I hear comments on this?
Is that part of our agenda, or is that?
No.
That's just a resolution. I got a question then, if you brought that up, and this is for the sheriff maybe. I know you guys get to go over to some of the apartments on Garden Road. Does that ever create any undue burden on the sheriff's department?
1789.
Yes and no.
I'm just curious. I mean, it is. I know there's some strips in there that just
there's a strip in there.
You're service right. Stuff that just makes sense. But I we'll keep it in the county. I guess no matter which way it goes.
I think the people should not be represented if they don't have representation on the Burlington City Council, and they do not.
No.
They should have a choice to remain where they please.
If the board's agreeable, we will. There's numerous resolutions out there that counties have done, and we'll be glad to put one on our agenda for the next meeting.
Well, it's going to be too late because they're voting on them tomorrow night, I think.
They're holding a hearing tomorrow night.
Yeah, it's tomorrow night. Hearing.
The public hearing is tomorrow night.
Are they trying to?
Some people need water.
I understand what some are saying. But isn't there a law that's getting ready to be changed in Raleigh that Burlington wouldn't have been able to have done this as quick or the way they're doing it?
I think there's a study commission that is looking at annexation, looking at changing some of the current rules and regulations, but you're probably talking that's going to happen in the long session, but they haven't come up with a consensus yet.
Is that when you put these on?
Don't cry, talent, Tom.
What is the pleasure of the board?
That's fine. You can put it on the next agenda, as far as I'm concerned.
It's too late for the next agenda.
It's too late for the next agenda.
It's tomorrow night.
They're going to meet tomorrow night. I'm sure they're going to make a decision.
I mean,
it's kind of...
But the power of the press is a strong thing. If the county commissioners come out against it, maybe the Burlington City Council will have a heart and postpone any decision that they make.
At this point, I don't know that we can do a resolution.
I don't think our board has a lot of influence in the city, to be honest. No, they're just having public hearing tomorrow night, so Thomas just said.
Yeah, I knew they were having.
I think they're going to take them in sections.
All right, I need some comments from the board.
Well, Bill's not going to like to hear this, but I'm going to say it anyway. I'm against annexation as much as anybody as far as why you do it and so forth. Like in the state of Virginia, you used to have to prove to a 3-judge panel that you needed, that services had to be, yeah, before they would allow that annexation. Okay, and then the state of Virginia changed the annexation process. And in all honesty, I haven't followed the debate that well. And I can't voice support for something just on reaction. And
actually, there's some of those that are already getting some of the services.
Yeah, I don't know that much about the debate. I mean, I have heard Joe Tickle. I saw the maps. I'm not going to lie to you. I looked at the maps. I've always opposed the fact that Burlington would annex around, say, poor areas. They didn't want to take Glen Raven. And they didn't want to go up on the outfall line and put in water and sewer at Hopedale because it was too expensive. Now, I object to that type of city involvement, and you were on city council when some of that was taking place. But not with your vote. Not with your
not
vote.
Not with my vote.
But
that's right.
I've always resented the fact that Burlington selected where to go based on money and worth more than true need. Glen Ravens, God knows, has needed services way before some of the other areas that they annexed. So did Hopedale. You had sewer running out in the lawn of these people, and they could throw a beer can to the northern outfall, and still Burlington wouldn't hook them up. But now that's the type of annexation or lack of that I object to. But I don't know enough about this one to say I've got a dog in the fight.
I think our grant ran some sewer to Glen Raven got.
Well, Hopedale. Yeah, if you go back far enough on Hopedale.
Is that not right? Did our grant do, Jason? Didn't we run some sewer lines to Glen Raven over on Flora Avenue?
Flora Avenue, we filled in a gap there, and that was literally, I don't know, maybe 1,000 feet or so from the city limits of Burlington.
But, you know, you're asking, all right, let me tell this one. There was, I got to go back on memory, Hopedale wanted... Burlington wanted the ETJ zone put out to a certain area that they were going to put service to. Eddie, you're familiar with that. Out on Sandy Cross Road, Burlington came out and said, well, if we're going to, and I made a prediction that they would request more than they needed to do that particular project. And sure enough, if you went about 2 miles up Sandy Cross Road, they had this guy's farm lopped out off the line just like that. It was like 200 acres or so many hundreds of acres. They wanted his farm. Had nothing to do with the project, nothing to do whatsoever. And our board said, you know, and I called the guy, and I said, do you realize that everybody in the county is talking about your property? And he said, what? He didn't understand ETJs, and he didn't understand annexation. I said, they're trying to get your farm. He said, I've got 2 wells. He said, it's been in my family for over 100 years. He said, I don't want nothing Burlington's got. And they were going to put him in, guaranteed. Well, we had a big public hearing here. He showed up with his family. Long story short, our board voted not to give Burlington the ETJ if they were going to take that guy's farm. And then Burlington said, well, we just won't provide the services that was initially being requested, which was just bribery at that point. And we said, well, you do what you want. And I think eventually they did provide the services. But annexation is a crooked process anyway. I agree with that.
Because they don't
get a vote on it. All I'm asking is for this board to ask the Burlington City Council not to annex anybody until there's a lot of time to talk about it.
I'm waiting on the wishes.
Well, I'm not the king and commander down here. I mean, you know, it's... I'll support anything where the people have a voice.
Me too.
If you want to say that's what
exactly
that is.
That's exactly what I want to say.
Yeah, but they got their public hearing tomorrow night.
The people should have a voice.
We'll see.
Just let the newspaper put this out?
Sure.
Rather than a resolution?
Right. We surely can.
So are we in agreement?
People do need to have a voice.
They certainly do.
Are we in agreement to that, Mr. Manning? Okay. We're in a consensus to that rather than to do
much.
A resolution. How about that?
Thank you very much.
Is that okay?
I'm happy, Phil.
Okay. Any more commissioner comments? How about announcements? Am I going to announce?
Well, then, Ann, I'm going to miss you. I know Ann and I differ on some things, but she's a good woman. I bet you were one heck of a teacher. I wish my kids had had you. Well, I'm serious. You're a good woman.
Tim, I hear she's not leaving me alone. She told me
you brought class to this board where I took it away at times, and I'm gonna miss you. Okay.
I'm gonna see if I need you guys.
All right, you go ahead. I'll be nice to you too.
All right.
Any other announcements? If not, we are adjourned.
Did you ever see?
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.